If you don't know me, I'm the chairman of the British Chamber of Commerce. Welcome to the British Business Centre, which is part of the British Chamber. Well, hold on. I don't know. There's always somebody who's late.
Okay.
You said 5 minutes.
I was joking. It's my great pleasure to welcome Antoine Barthez, who's the president of Nissan Motors in Thailand. Now, you all know Nissan, you've all heard of Nissan, and I think I can remember driving a Nissan car in the UK twice, on two different occasions, and I loved it. But normally when I go back to the UK, I hire cars, so you don't really get that sort of level of choice normally. Nowadays, of course, we're into a completely new development phase, which is going to be part of your responsibility in Thailand, I understand. And that is to deal with the development of electric motoring and all that entails. And we're going to hear tonight about the Nissan's plans, what Nissan plans to do in Thailand, but perhaps more in Southeast Asia as well. And some of the technology behind the developments that are going to take place in motoring, driving cars, or not driving cars actually, in the future, are going to be staggering. People like me, who've been around a few more years than most of you, can remember when cars had four gears, and a steering wheel, and a brake, and a clutch, and an accelerator. And you did everything else yourself, apart from the lights, of course. Nowadays, a lot of that is automatic. Some of the things that happen, I was watching a program just out of interest on the A1 road in the UK. And there was a big crash, the police had to turn up, it was a big lorry. And the reason the lorry had crashed was because its brakes came on so fiercely when it felt that there was an accident going to happen that the whole thing jackknifed. Now, those are the sort of things, those are the horror stories that we hear about, but of course those sort of things will be ironed out very quickly. So, without any more from me, can we please give a big introduction, a big British Chamber introduction, to Antoine Barthez, the president of Nissan Thailand.
Sawadee krap, a very nice good evening to all of you. First of all, because I'm in the British Chamber of Commerce, I'd like to apologize in advance for my French accent and for my Franglish. You need to know that I'm working a lot on this and I try not to change it, because French touch is important, but please pardon me if you don't understand, if you have any issue, just let me know. I'll try to explain it in more proper English. Thanks a lot for inviting us to have a short discussion tonight. I have a few slides, and the objective is to provide you and to give you our vision at Nissan about the changes the automotive industry is going through right now. And how do we see the future, and how do we need to evolve together with the market and the customer in order to embrace those changes. I'd like to start with a quick video which we created a few months ago, because we had a big event in Singapore where we invited many policymakers, many governments, many private entities to discuss about those changes and to discuss about the evolution of the automotive business, but the environment we are operating in. And I think it's an important, it's an interesting introduction to set up the scene for tonight. If it works. Should click once. Thank you. basically high-level vision of how we see the future coming. Before moving to this, one very quick word about Nissan. Hopefully you all know Nissan, founded 85 years ago. First car, which was not a Nissan, by the way, which was a Datsun, but four wheels, one steering wheel, engine. I don't know whether this was four gears or less at that time, but for sure, far less technology than what we see in our cars today, far less. A lot of engineering excitement, so I think this remains within today, but the level of technology between those first cars and the cars that we are seeing in the streets today are totally different. We still have a steering wheel in the car we are producing, but I'm not sure how long that will last, and that's very clear. Engines as well have seen major evolution, and now we are moving more towards electrification, and that's a fact. And I think the cars and the place of the cars in our daily life is definitely changing a lot. They are far more than simply just a vehicle to move you from A to B, but they are an expression and an extension of people's lifestyle and the way, the image they want to reflect to the society when they are choosing and driving a car. And this evolution is not simply linked to engineers and their intention to have fun and to add more and more technologies within the car. This is clearly driven by the market and by our customers. We see a definite trend and expectation from the customers to increase the level of technology that they have access to within the car. We know that millennials are a core for it, and by 2020, we know that around 40% of the buyer of a new car will be millennials. What does that mean? And particularly in Southeast Asia, it's very, very important. Why? We know that they are the most digitally connected customers across the globe, and particularly in Southeast Asia, they are even more connected than the average globally. We know that in Southeast Asia, there is roughly 1.4 active mobile line more than people. So it means that it's not very common to meet people with two or more mobile phone in the street. I was telling that to my team earlier on today, but I took the BTS a few days ago and I was next to somebody who had a plastic sheet with three mobile phones stuck on it, and he was juggling from one mobile to the other instantly. So highly, highly connected, very, very digital. We know also that the Thai people are spending a bit less than 10 hours online every day. And they are spending an average of 3 hours and 10 minutes on social media, which is a bit worrying for those of you who are running a business, because either they do that fully outside of the business hours, or they find some time to do that in the office. But this is absolutely massive, and this is number four in the world. It's only behind Brazil, Philippines, and Indonesia. So you see that the level of connectivity in Southeast Asia is absolutely stunning, and this is something we need to take into consideration when we design our product and when we look to the future. And obviously, when those people are driving, they are expecting the same level of connection in their car than what they have today, every day, with their tablet, with their mobile phone, etc., etc. That's why we are seeing a lot and more connected vehicles, cloud application, etc., etc. And this is obviously a trend we are following in the company, in Nissan, but we are going far beyond this. So our vision for the future is what we call the Nissan Intelligent Mobility. And this is made of three pillars, basically. And the three pillars are just behind me. The power, so the way the car is being powered, the intelligent driving, and the intelligent integration. So not only looking at the car in isolation, and not anymore a tool to move you from A to B, but definitely part of an overall ecosystem which will embed the power, so the way the car is being powered, so we can have different solutions, the way the car is being driven, whether you want to drive it, whether you want it to drive you, and the way the car is being integrated within the society and the overall ecosystem. This is our way to drive people to a smarter and a better future. We think that definitely we need to have a holistic approach and an overall understanding on those three dimensions so that we can move the society to the next step. We have also a very important objective with the zero fatality, which will be part of this and which will be clearly connected to those three dimensions. But let's have a look, because I think we have another video right after to give you a better understanding of what do we mean with the intelligent mobility. Ways to introduce those technologies to the customer. We could decide, for instance, because this has a certain cost, we go and we offer those technologies only on our flagship in the top of the range, and that's not the direction that we've decided to take in the company. We have decided to democratize those technology as much as possible, and we offer those technology in most of our lineup, and we try to roll it out as quickly as possible throughout the various car lines that we have. If you take, for example, the latest car that we've launched and we've announced it a few weeks ago, the new intelligent frame-based SUV, which is called the Nissan Terra, which is basically offering few technologies that you can't find anywhere else. We have the smart rearview monitor, the smart rearview mirror, sorry, the intelligent around view monitor with moving object detection, intelligent 4x4, which, when you combine all these, will help you handle any kind of terrain, any kind of road you will go to, and will give the driver full confidence in the way he can behave with the car. We also have a security and safety dimension in there. So we have blind spot warning, we have lane departure warning, which again will give confidence and reassurance to the customer on the way the car is behaving and the way he's handling the car. But we also have, and this is the famous Terra I was talking about, but we also have our Nissan Intelligent Mobility flagship. And I want to stop there for a minute. The new Nissan Leaf. Electric vehicle and full electric vehicle. So full battery EV, which means that there is no petrol in the car and there is zero emission out of the car. This is the most, or the world's best-selling electric vehicle in the world. We've sold more than 350,000 units. I know many people are very surprised when I say that. And it's not an American brand, which is the most, the best-selling electric vehicle in the world. This is the Nissan Leaf. And the Nissan Leaf is available throughout the world since 2010, which means that we have around more than 8 years of experience with the electric vehicle at Nissan. And we are going to launch this car in Thailand within this fiscal year. And when I talk about this, and when I talk to many people, people are looking at me, and very often, after being very polite and starting to be honest, they are telling me, you have a problem of infrastructure in Thailand because you don't have any charger. On top of that, people, they don't need an electric vehicle. What's the benefit? What's the interest? You will never sell. And I truly, truly believe that with the electric vehicle in Thailand, we can make a real difference. We've launched a study a few months ago with Frost and Sullivan, and we just discovered that there is around 1 out of 3 who is ready to look to an electric vehicle as an alternative for a traditional car when they will renew their car. And on top of that, out of those, there is around 40 to 45% of those people who are telling we are ready to pay up to 50% more to have an equivalent EV variant as a traditional car. We need to be a bit careful because obviously all kind of study, you can turn it the way you want, you can go to conclusion, and that could be a bit dangerous. But the main conclusion to me out of those survey and research is that there is an awareness about battery EV vehicle in Thailand. There is a certain level of expectation out of battery EV in Thailand. And there is an understanding that technology has a cost, but the people, or part of the people, are ready today to spend more and get access to this new technology, understanding that this is beneficial for them and that they might need to pay more, but they are ready to do so. Very, very important. So ultimately, I don't know whether I'm right or wrong, hopefully I'm not so wrong, and in a few weeks or months' time, we will see where we stand with the new Leaf, but I think that there is definitely an interest and a high expectation for the Leaf in Thailand. And the objective of the company is to sell globally around 1 million electric vehicle by 2022. Electric vehicle and electrification does not necessarily mean full battery EV. And there are some other alternatives. Electrifying the car park without going to the full battery EV. One of the alternatives that we have in the company is e-power. And if some of you know what e-power is, this is a kind of hybrid, but instead of having the traditional engine, which is moving the wheels, the electric motor is moving the wheel, and the traditional engine is simply used to charge the battery. What does that mean? It means that you have a totally different experience when you're driving the car. And for those of you who've never had the opportunity to drive an electric vehicle, I really encourage you to try one. Whoever the brand, whoever the model, but just sit behind the steering wheel, which is still existing today, and try it. If you have the feeling, or if you have in your mind the golf cart as a comparison for the electric vehicle, you will be absolutely, absolutely bluffed. Driving an electric vehicle means that you have the full torque available as from the start. You have no noise, and you have smoothness when you're driving because there is no gearbox, basically. So it means that the driving pleasure of an EV is very, very high. And I'm saying that not because I'm believing in the EV, but I'm saying that because this is what we've asked in Japan a few weeks ago to a panel of EV buyer. And not only Nissan, but we went to EV buyer and we asked them, okay, why did you buy your EV? And we were expecting, okay, they will say, we bought the EV because of environment friendliness, we wanted to go green. The main decision factor was the driving pleasure. And most of them, the vast majority of them, explain they decided to buy the car once they did the test drive, and after having realized how surprising and bluffing the driving dynamics of the car were, they decided to go to the EV. E-power is interesting because this gives you the same feeling, but this is killing one of the obstacles that some people are having when they need to go to an EV, which is the range anxiety. And that's true that, particularly in Thailand today, the level of infrastructure is limited. It's going to increase in the coming months and years, hopefully. There is a significant plan from the authority, and there are some private entities who are investing as well to create some infrastructure and charger and quick charger, but it's still relatively limited. So some people are just thinking, it's not for me because if I'm running out of electricity, what am I going to do? But the point is that the latest generation of EV are offering an autonomy which is more than enough for most of the people in the big cities. How many of you today are driving more than 100 kilometers a day? I'm not asking you how long do you spend in your car. That's a very different thing. I'm asking you how much kilometers do you drive? I made the analysis, and we have two factories down in Bangna. When I look at the average over the last 6 months, I never go above 90 kilometers. Never. Except when I need to go outside for a weekend, a meeting, etc. But during the weekday, I never go above 90 kilometers. The new Leaf has a range of around, depending on which homologation data you will look at, but we are talking around 350 to 400 kilometers. So it means that depending on the way you drive, depending on your consumption with the AC, etc., this might decrease a bit, but you will never run out of electricity with 90 kilometers a day. And it means that you will not need to charge it every day. And I think that the way we are looking at it and this round anxiety at Nissan is we need to come up with a solution and give reinsurance to the customer. One way to do that is to try to speed up the level of infrastructure across the countries. It's a bit complicated. We are not the only one playing part to this. Another way to give them reinsurance is to secure that they are having a clear possibility to charge their car at home. When they come back from the office, they plug the car, and the next morning, the car is ready and can be used. With this level of autonomy, if they need to go to friends, family, and go overnight, can't be back home, no problem. They can survive easily 2 or 3 days with 90 kilometers. So my point there is to say there are barriers that we will need to overcome. They are blockers in people's minds, but there is an education to be made as well to explain them that depending on the utilization they have with their car, EV is a very good solution. An EV for a city like Bangkok, or if you go to Jakarta, Manila, EV is a perfect solution. Zero emission, silence. You can handle the traffic jam without any problem on with an electric vehicle. And when we will go towards the autonomy, an autonomous drive, knowing that this is easier to implement that type of technology on an EV, EV is a perfect solution. And if we go, if we look even beyond the car and the usage of the car, EV will enable some of the customers to have a very different relationship with their car. The picture you see here is what we call vehicle to grid. Today, a car is a cost center. I'm not talking about very few brands where you can buy them and resell them at a higher value after a few years, but most of the time, cars cost money. You can find better cars than others in terms of cost of ownership, but it's a cost center. With an electric vehicle like Leaf, you have a possibility to use your car as an energy storage. What does that mean? It means that during the low peak hour, you can charge your Leaf with the cost of an electricity, which is relatively small. You have this energy which is stored in your car, and then you can give back the energy at certain point in time to the grid. And this is not science fiction. This is existing in Europe, and we have some customers who are making money out of their car. It means that if they don't need necessarily the full charge of their car, they just sell back the electricity that they have in their car to the grid. And when there are peak of consumptions, we have some consumer who are happy to receive this energy, and this is supporting also the energy provider. This is a totally different way of thinking, and this is a totally different way of interacting with the car. Very, very different. We can say as well that, and it says I'm not connected, I don't know why, but let me check. I need an IT expert. We have also the possibility to reuse the Leaf battery. Obviously, once the car is not being used anymore, the battery and the battery life is not over. And those batteries can be reused. We have some business schemes where we are offering the possibility to some individual, private, to have some former battery Leaf or Leaf battery and use them at home. Exactly the same concept. Use them as a kind of electricity storage, which is powering the house during the time they are home and charging during the time when the electricity is cheaper. We have also some bigger scale example. This is one of the stadiums in Holland, which is fully powered through Leaf battery. So we took the battery, we recycled the battery, and the batteries are powering the stadium. The headquarters of Nissan in Europe is powered by Leaf battery. Same concept, charged during the night, during the day when the employees are coming, the electricity is given out of the Leaf battery. Significant savings in terms of running cost. And very reliable. This is up and running since more than a year now, and there was absolutely no issue, no problem at all. So you see that this is giving some different business opportunity and a very, very different way of interacting with the car. I touched upon very, very shortly about autonomous drive. And again, this is also not science fiction. This is coming, and I'm sure you've read in the press. This is also existing on some cars. This is also existing on some Nissan cars. And this will be coming for sure. Now, I don't know you, but I like driving. I like driving a lot. And I would love, and I want to be given the choice. It means that sometimes I would be happy to drive. Most of the time in Bangkok, I would be very happy not to drive. And pressing a button and letting the car drive on its own would definitely be a very, very good solution and a very good opportunity. And this is definitely coming. We have today on some of our cars what we call ProPilot, which is pressing a button on the motorway and the car will drive on its own on one lane and will be totally autonomous. The only thing the car is not doing is it's not overtaking, not because we don't have the technology, but because there are some steps that we need to do. And again, that's an important point that we need to take into consideration. All this is a big change in the overall regulation. And most of the regulation on automotive in the countries are relatively old. And they never took into consideration that type of technology. And this is raising a few concerns or questions. If you're driving an autonomous car and if the car is being driven on its own as an autonomous mode, and if there is an accident, who's responsible? The human can say, I was not driving, the car was driving. The insurance company might say, the car was driving, but the responsibility is towards the car manufacturer. But the car manufacturer will always say, we were not in the car, there was no default in our car, not obvious default. So, raising many, many questions, and there will need to be an adjustment in terms of overall regulation at the same time as there is an evolution on the level of technology in the car. And today, this is being discussed and raising several concerns. We don't have the real answer at that point in time. I don't think anybody's got the proper answer, but this is definitely a big, big change in the environment. And this is, why am I raising the point? Because this is a limitation to the rollout of the technology. Technology is existing. There are many technologies existing. And I'm not talking only about Nissan. There are many technologies existing in the industry, but not necessarily the possibility to roll them out today because the pace the technology is moving is not necessarily aligned with the overall environment the car is operating in. Another technology, ProPilot Park or Park Assist. You can park your car today by pressing a button. You just decide where you want to park it, you just tell it to the car, and then the car will park the car on its own. Very useful, less complicated, lower risk in terms of damaging your car, etc., etc. Lower risk towards the environment as well. If there is a kid going behind, running behind the ball, etc., the car will just see it and stop automatically. So, again, same point, a lot of technologies available, a lot of technologies being rolled out, a lot of technologies ready to be rolled out today, but not necessarily the environment following to do so. Let me end by giving you a quick idea of what could be the future. This is a new technology that we disclosed at the CES earlier this year. This is called brain-to-vehicle technology. The objective of this technology is to connect closer the driver to the car. So, don't dream. It's not because you think about Starbucks that the car will drive you to the first coffee shop or etc. But the technology is made of securing that this is a step further on the autonomy and try to understand and analyze the driver situation to increase the reactiveness of the car. So, for instance, the car will analyze and try to understand when you want to accelerate, the car will understand it and will start accelerating a bit earlier than your foot will do. Same on the brake. You want to brake, car will understand it and will start braking a bit earlier than what you would do. This is the future. This is the first system of this kind. It's never been explained or disclosed by anybody else. This is really purely Nissan. But this is how we think the future will be. So a combination of autonomy and virtual intelligence, if you want, who will further improve the capacity of the autonomy. If I'm not wrong, I should have a video on the next slide. So that's it, moving people to a better world. That's what I wanted to share with you. It's very quick. We could discuss a very, very long time on this. There are many dimensions that I did not touch upon. For instance, there is a lot of industrial implication as well. There is implication on the way we are doing our business in the automotive with our network, dealers, etc. Many things, but at least hopefully you get the understanding and the vision of Nissan. We want to move people to a better world, and we are convinced that the future will be autonomous, connected, and electric. That's definitely the three keywords of my small speech. It's interesting to end up with this concept car, because this concept car can let you decide whether you want a steering wheel or not. And I'm not joking, it's a reality. Inside you see that there is the steering wheel, which is there when you decide to drive, but if you press the button to go on the autonomous drive, the steering wheel is going down, and you don't have any steering wheel anymore in the car. So that's definitely how the future will look like in this very near future. Very near future. D'accord.
Some questions.
I got a lot of time for many questions, if there are any questions.
Over to you, I'm sure there are lots of questions. First one.
Okay, how do you reconcile the NSR with all this development?
Sorry?
The NSR, which is the ultimate driving car with the electric car, your sports car.
Ah, the GTR.
GTR, yeah.
GTR is... the way the car is powered is important. You remember I said Nissan Intelligent Mobility, we have the three pillars, and we have the way the car is powered, the way the car is integrated, etc. This GTR is a kind of UFO within this, because obviously you don't want GTR to be autonomous, I can tell you.
Absolutely.
When you have the keys of a GTR, you want to drive. You don't want to let it drive. However, if we look at the way the car is being driven, there is still also a dimension of intelligent mobility. We've worked a lot on this car, on the efficiency, fuel consumption, etc., etc. So that's somehow a dimension of the way the car is being powered. But I will not lie to you. GTR is not necessarily the way we know the GTR today. Is not necessarily the future of the industry. Having said that, I hope there will still be some offers giving the same driving pleasure, probably different way. But if you think a minute about an electric GTR, that would be fantastic. There was, just for the record, for those who don't know GTR, GTR is the sports car at Nissan. This is around 555 horsepower. This is one of the fastest car in the overall industry. And this is, from a production car, the car who's got the record lap at the Nürburgring. So this is a fast car. There was just for fun, a quick comparison which was made between a GTR and a Leaf. Starting from zero, acceleration. On the first 50 meters, the Leaf is winning. But it gives you an idea of what I was talking about on the driving dynamics and the driving pleasure of an EV. Because the GTR, it's a V6, you need to start the engine, you need to go a bit higher in the RPM. With the Leaf, you start pressing the accelerator, boom, you leave immediately. It's very funny because we asked, I remember by that time I was in France, and we asked some customers of Leaf at the very beginning, back in 2010, when we delivered the first Leaf. And we were asking them, what do you think about the car, etc., etc. And many of them came back to us and were smiling and said, you know what is the most exciting with the Leaf? No. They say, when I'm at the red light, everybody's looking at me, and particularly the motorbike. There are a lot of motorbikes in Paris, but not the small scooter that you see here, but larger motorbike. And they are all looking at me, and like, but that one, that. And when the lamp turns green, I'm ahead of them. And they were just so happy with this. And that's the reality. And that's a very, very different feeling. So to answer straight your question, GTR, wonderful car, marvelous, a big UFO within this overall environment, and probably we'll see some changes if we see a next generation GTR.
You're the next, I think. With regards to the tyre market, I work in emission, chemicals related to emissions. In terms of surveys and things done for this market, do you think that the key buying prompts are environment or keeping up with digital development, or what is it? Because a lot of the noise that I'm getting bringing a new product to this market, which is environmentally friendly and related to automotive vehicles, is that there just isn't the market really, on the basis that it's not a massive sell for the main general public.
The surveys we've done are showing three types of customer. The first type is pragmatic buyer. People who are looking at the car and they say, okay, an EV will help me reducing my cost of ownership, reducing my cost on the petrol. This is simple and cheaper to service, etc. So very pragmatic. The second group is tech seeker. So people who are excited about the technology, they want to jump and they want to go on something new, and they want to try the EV. The third group is green, but this is the smallest group amongst the three. So there is still a dimension. There is still an environmental consciousness, if you want. But when we look at those intenders, this portion is the smallest one. And again, if because time market, it's all about surveys, but we complicate it because there is no offer, and people will discover the car. But when we look at the other market where we are selling since 2010, we see that environmental as a decision factor to buy the car is not in the top five. So this is